Okay, brothers and sisters, this is my second video. And then while I was just praying, the Lord just dropped this text on me from Isaiah chapter 61. Now, the Lord Jesus Christ read from this text, okay, and he was reading from the Septuagint, and it's translated from the Septuagint, which is the Greek version of the Old Testament from about 200 B.C. It was written there in Alexandria, Egypt, by this 70 plus 2. That's why they call it the Septuagint. So when you see the translation into the King James, it doesn't match the King James translation of 61, Isaiah, because the Isaiah 61 text is from the Masoretic Hebrew text, which is found in the Dead Sea Scrolls. But at the time of the King James, the oldest known copy was about 900 A.D. And all these God-haters and atheists and all that said, because the Jewish scribes, they would destroy the old copies because they had holes in them and people couldn't read them right. Someone tried to translate and just add on. So their custom was to destroy the old text so that someone couldn't get a hold of it. And some of the words is like blotted out because it's so old and they just make up whatever they want. So as new copies were made, it's just like money in America. When the old dollars are looking raggedy, they destroy them. Same thing they did with the scrolls of the Old Testament. So that's why the oldest copy until the Dead Sea Scrolls was found was a Masoretic text. So now that we have the Dead Sea Scrolls, we find out there's actually the copper scroll is the book of Isaiah. That's the centerpiece of, the building there of the Dead Sea Scrolls, which by the grace of God, may the Lord make a way that I go there and see that place. It would be one of the greatest experiences in my human life to go there and see where the Dead Sea Scrolls are. And the building is shaped like a scroll, and it's about the copper scroll. The copper scroll is an actual copper copy of the book of Isaiah. And the difference between the 900 AD text and the copper scroll is just minuscule, like one letter added to the spelling of one of those long Hebrew kings' names. You know, they got those names, Obadiah, Hezekiah, all these different names. And some of them, they're 100 times more wacky than that are hard to pronounce, hard to spell. And those are the difference between the, there's like a 1,100 year gap between the Dead Sea Scroll, copper scroll of Isaiah, and the copy that was used to make the King James. And, like I said, there are errors that had developed after being transcribed over 1,100 years by different scribes. And the errors are small, one letter added to the spelling of a name, something like that. These kind of things. And instead of saying the Lord God, it says, God the Lord or something like that. Those kind of things. Anyway, you can go research that yourself. But you can rest assured that the text we have is the same as the text was in 200 B.C. And an added letter to a spelling of a name does by no means change the meaning of the text, right? There's no text meaning changes. And anyway, I just want to throw that out there. Anyway, so reading from Isaiah 61 is the text the Lord really spoke to me. Jesus read from the text and stopped at the words, acceptable year of the Lord, which is the year of Jubilee, is what it's talking about. The church age is the year of Jubilee. I've talked about this before, that we are in the year of Jubilee, and I had someone that kept private messaging me saying, are you saying that the rapture is this year? This is the year of Jubilee. And I tried to explain it to them 10 times. They wanted to hear that the rapture was in 2012. That was last year. The year of Jubilee is the, when God says like the year of our Lord, the tribulation period is called, the year that's not even the year. Maybe it's even the hour of God's judgment, and things like that. It uses this expression, but it doesn't literally mean an hour. It's a small, short season. If I say, the day of the Lord, it's called the day of the Lord. It's not one day. It's the 7-year tribulation period. And it's, a short season. In this case, a 7-year tribulation. So a day. The day of the Lord. So the year of Jubilee in this case is for us in the Old Testament every 50 years, every 7 sevens, okay, they had 49 years. And the 50th year was a year of Jubilee where all debt was canceled, all property was returned to the original family, all this kind of stuff. So 3 years before the year of Jubilee, if you wanted to loan, give me a loan on my land like I do here in the Philippines, the coconut farms were giving the owner a loan and then we get the harvest of his land. And then after 15 years, or depends on the contract, the land would go back to him. He would give me back the original money I loaned him. But in the meantime, my interest is to harvest the coconuts off his land. That's what we're trying to do. We've got some. We need more to support the orphanage. That's an example. Well, in Israel, if it's 3 years to the Jubilee and you ask me, can you loan me $1,000 on my land? And I would say to you, your land's only worth you know, $1,000, and then I got to give it back to you in 3 years. What benefit it would be to me? So, you know, they would prorate. It even talks about that in the Old Testament. They would reduce the amount to say, okay, since it's only 3 years, give me $300. And then, you know, after 3 years, I'll get my land back at the year Jubilee, and then you're good to go. So you get to use my land for 3 years. And I get, you know, a reasonable amount of money equal to the shortened amount of time. Now, if it's the first year of a new cycle, well, hey, it's 49 years, I'm going to have your land. Then, you know, I would give you the full amount, or maybe even more than it's worth, because I'm going to get to use it for really probably all of my life, 49 years. So that's how it worked in the natural. 7-7. You know, God does everything in sevens. He created in seven. In the tribulation period, we see seven trumpets, seven seals, seven bowls. Don't let me forget about that. Seven seals. That's what the message that the Lord gave me to talk to you about specifically. So there's seven sevens. So with God, seven is completion, then seven times seven is completion of completion, the end of the age. That's what it's talking about. So those things in the Old Testament, just like I've talked about before, just as you should know if you're a Christian, the Passover lamb, as it says in Hebrews, is not, it's a shadow of things to come, but not the very image of the thing. The very image was Christ is the Lamb of God that takes away the sins of the world. Christ is the Passover lamb. The angel of death will pass over you if you have the blood of Christ over the doorpost of your hearts. And those things are types and shadows. So another type of shadow that these Gentiles who say they are Jews and are not try to copy and try to get into the natural things that God gave us to show us the way to the Messiah, to the Christ, to the Son of the living God, to Jesus, the lily of the valley, the bright and morning star, the rose of Sharon, Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus the Messiah. All of those things show the way to the Christ. When Jesus read from this text about the year of Jubilee, the acceptable year of the Lord, which is really the age of grace, the church age, the year of the Lord, the acceptable year of the Lord, the year of Jubilee is the church age, the age of grace. All debts are forgiven. All debts are canceled. All property that the enemy has stolen from you shall be returned to you, to the owner. All things in the spirit and in the natural be given back to you. As Jesus told us, Matthew 6:33, seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all the earthly things you need will be added unto you. Everything the devil stole from you, the law says a thief steals, it must be returned fourfold. God will return it to you. The Bible in the Old Testament says, and we've been redeemed from the curse of the law, but we still have the blessings of the law. And the blessings of the law says, when the enemy shall come at you one way, the Lord will scatter him seven ways. Seven ways. There's that seven again. That's the number of completion of the work of God Almighty himself. Now, Jesus quoted from this text, and the Lord wanted me to quote this text to you. Okay? Listen to this. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me. Upon who? Jesus said, when Jesus read this text, he said, the Spirit, today the scripture is fulfilled in your hearing. This is talking about Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus the Christ. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because the Lord hath anointed me to preach good tidings unto the meek. He has sent me to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives, to open the prison to them that are bound, to proclaim the acceptable year of our Lord. That's the church age, which we are still in until the rapture happens. And the day of the vengeance of our God. That's the tribulation period. Jesus didn't read that part. He stopped because he knew it was going to be 2,000 years plus until the rest of this text was fulfilled, which we are on the brink. We are at the last twilight seconds of the acceptable year of our Lord, the church age. Today is the day of salvation. Today is the day to come into the ark. Jesus has set you free. And that's what Jesus, the Lord Jesus Christ, wanted me to tell you. Those whom the Son has set free are free indeed. Now, I need to stay with this text, but I want to skip ahead now. People, you know, this is about Revelation. At the beginning of Revelation, after the Lord rebukes the churches and blesses the churches, and the rapture happens, Revelation chapter 4, verse 1, there is no more mention of the church. The church is in heaven, as John is our example of that. John is called up, come up here, and I will show you great, you know, I'll show you things that will come to pass later on, which will happen later. So John goes up there to the throne room as a representation of the church. He sees the 24 elders with their crowns. No one is given a crown until after the judgment seat of Christ for the church, which is after the resurrection of the church, aka the rapture. The elders have their crowns already. The judgment seat of Christ has already happened there at the throne, the bema seat of Christ, it's called. And so they already have their crowns. That does not happen. Nobody has a crown in heaven yet until the judgment seat of Christ, which happens after the bride is there, brothers and sisters. This is basic theology 101, that the rapture is pre-trib and it's imminent. Now, when we, the church, are there before the throne of God, it says that the call goes out to heaven, who is worthy to open the seals off of this scroll? Now, this is what the Lord wanted me to tell you today, that Jesus Christ is worthy. It's the angel told Paul, told John, weep not, for the Lamb of God and the Lion of the tribe of Judah has been found worthy to open the scroll. Now, let me tell you something about that scroll. Do you know what that scroll is? Do you know what that scroll is? 99% of you do not know what that scroll is. I will tell you what it is. It's the title deed to this earth and to mankind that Adam, that moron, and his wife, that misleading woman, led Adam into eating that fruit and was beguiled by the serpent, and then she beguiled her husband to eat that fruit. And they gave up the title deed to this earth, that God gave Adam dominion over this earth. And yes, all you Jezebel spirit American women, God gave Adam dominion over Eve. Eve is supposed to be the helpmate of Adam, not rule over him. And the biggest problem in the American church, not in the Filipino church, but in the American church, is American women trying to rule and lord over their husband. Now, that's the biggest spiritual problem in the United States. In the church is the Jezebel spirit. It's not about promiscuity, but lording over. Jezebel lorded over her husband, Ahab, King Ahab. She ruled over him. That's the biggest problem in the American church. That's a whole nother video. But Adam and Eve lost the title deed. Adam lost the title deed to this earth to Satan. Jesus has already made his kingdom spiritual. When Jesus Christ returns to rule and reign on this earth, Satan is still the god of this world in the natural. Jesus said his kingdom is not of this world. It is within us. It is a spiritual kingdom during the church age. Now, when Jesus Christ literally returns to earth, he will literally rule and reign on this earth 1,000 years with a rod of iron. He will crush his enemies with a rod of iron. His vestments, his clothes will be covered in the blood of his enemies. Go read your Bible. He is coming back as a King of Kings and Lord of Lords, not the suffering servant dying on the cross. All the people of the world, part of the gospel, and the message that those God-hating, rebellious child of the devil in San Francisco, in Seattle, in Las Vegas, all those places I went, and in Lebanon, Tennessee, what they need to hear is Jesus is coming back and you're not going to crucify him again. You're not going to spit on him, pull his beard and mock him and all the things that man did to Jesus the first time, because that has already been fulfilled. To create the church age, the acceptable year of the Lord, where people, anybody, whomsoever could come to the Lord and he would in no wise cast them out, he said. That God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever shall believe in him would not perish, but have everlasting life, a.k.a. born again, a.k.a. going to heaven, saved, covered by the blood of Jesus, free from the law of sin and death. Jesus is setting us free from the curse of the law, but not the blessings. Praise God, we still have the blessings of the law, but not the curse. The Hebrews tells us it's a better covenant. There ain't never been no better deal than what God offers us, a full, complete pardon by the blood of Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus the Christ. There's never been a deal ever been offered on this earth. You've heard the expression, if something's too good to be true, it probably is. This is the only exception you will ever see to that rule, because God's deal is too good to be true, and that's why people miss it. That's why it's a stumbling block to those Jehovah Witnesses and those sacred namers and those Judaizers and people trying to keep the law, when Peter himself and Paul and James, the half-brother of Jesus, said, we are not able to keep the law. We Jews are not able to keep the law. And there's no way that the Gentiles will be able to keep something that they didn't even get raised in even knowing. And that is why, by the grace of God, the law, the Bible says, is a schoolmaster to bring us to the knowledge of sin and death. It's just like a stop sign. A stop sign on the road. There's a stop sign there that tells me I need to stop. When I drive through there without stopping, I have violated the law. I am guilty of violating the law, and I cannot go back and undo that. No matter how many times I drive good and stop at that light, there was the day that I ran that light. I could go kill one person and live like an angel the rest of my life, but I'm still a murderer. I can't undo the murder that I did. I will never be able to undo it in my flesh. There is only one way to remove that murder charge off of me. That's through the blood of Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ took my place. He says, I take the judgment. I take the punishment. I take the guilt and the punishment of what you did. There's never been such a thing ever heard in the ears of man. No, I have seen or ear have heard the things that God has prepared for his people through the blood of Yeshua HaMashiach, through Jesus the Christ. Listen to me, brothers and sisters. That title deed that Jesus is holding in Revelation chapter 4 and 5, along in there, he's holding the title deed of this earth, and he is the only one. That's what the Lord wanted me to tell you. It says, in heaven they're shouting and looking for someone who's worthy to open it, and no one was found. No one was worthy to open up that title deed. So how do you, the Lord wants me to ask you, how do you think by your righteous deeds you think, as the Bible says, are filthy rags, the deeds that you've done, helping the widows, giving money for orphanages, building an orphanage, helping an old lady across the street in your Boy Scout suit, is a filthy rag in the eyes of the Lord, the Bible says. And yet you think that you are worthy to earn your way to heaven, to make your own salvation? You're saved because of the things you've done? Didn't you read in Revelation what I just told you, where it says they looked all through heaven for someone worthy to open the seals on that title deed to earth, to take that title deed back from Satan for the souls of mankind? And guess what? No one was found worthy to open that scroll. Only one, the Lamb of God, who is also the Lion of the tribe of Judah. John saw the Lion. He saw the Lamb right there in the midst of the throne. And it says, the Lion of the tribe of Judah has triumphed, for he is worthy to open the book. Hallelujah. Then they begin to, the hallelujah choir starts hallelujahing, which hallelujah is a Hebrew word, which means praise Yahweh. Hallelujah. They were praising God because one was found worthy. Only one. It wasn't you. It wasn't you. It wasn't you and your Judaizing. It wasn't you keeping the Passover. It wasn't you keeping Hanukkah. It wasn't you not having a Christmas tree. It wasn't you telling everybody they're going to hell because they have an Easter celebration at their house. No, it wasn't you. It wasn't all those YouTube Judaizers. No, 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 no. It was Jesus was the only one who was found worthy to open those scrolls. Not me and not you. Definitely not you, Judaizer, and definitely not me. But Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus the Christ, he's the only one who's worthy to open up the scroll. Listen to what he says. This is something else the Lord wants me to tell you, brothers and sisters. I want you to be excited about this. I want you to rejoice. This is a text the Lord awarded me to read to you. To give to them beauty for ashes. Ashes that people put on when they're mourning and in fasting and prayer. Beauty for ashes. The oil of joy for mourning. The garment of praise for the spirit of heaviness, that they might be called the trees of righteousness, the planting of the Lord, that he might be glorified. The Lord wants you to know that he's going to give you specifically in this text the oil of joy for mourning. The Lord is releasing the oil of his joy. The oil of his joy. You know, there's a rock that oil comes out of, the Bible talks about. It's talking about the Jesus, the Messiah, the anointing, the Holy Spirit. There's a rock, Jesus. And then the Holy Spirit comes out of that rock. When the rock is smote, oil comes out. That is the Holy Spirit. When Jesus was crucified, then he ascended into heaven. Then the Holy Spirit was given on the day of Pentecost, the oil of joy. God wants you to have the oil of his joy. That's the Holy Spirit. The Lord commands you in Jesus' name to be a witness unto him. Not an option. You know, I've been repeating what I heard other people say in the past. Oh, you know, there's the people that even believe in the baptism of the Holy Spirit, and they'll say, well, you know, you don't. Well, if I don't have to have that to go to heaven, then I ain't worried about it. God commands us, the Lord commands us, the great commission, the great commandment Go ye in all the world, making disciples of them. You know, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. And Jesus said at the end of Mark chapter 16, he says, these signs shall follow those that believe in my name. They will cast out devils. In my name, they will speak in new tongues. In my name, they will lay hands on the sick, and they shall recover. The Lord commands us to be a witness to him. He said, told the disciples, tarry in Jerusalem until you receive power from on high to be a witness for me. God wants us, desires us. Jesus said, if you love me, you'll keep my commandments. If you love the Lord, if you love the Lord God Almighty, how is it that you're satisfied with your lukewarm joke of a walk in Christ? You cannot walk in the power of the Spirit without the power of the Holy Spirit. It said, those who are led by the Spirit, these are the sons of God. Romans 8:14. Those who are led by the Spirit, these are the sons of God. How can you be led by the Spirit and you haven't been filled with the Spirit? Don't give me all, I don't want to hear no old Pharisee, old denominational people talking about how they're filled with the Holy Spirit. I don't want to hear it. That's not true. That is a lie, lie, lie. When you get saved, you're sealed with the Holy Spirit, but you're not filled with the Holy Spirit. You're not walking in the power. Jesus said, tarry in Jerusalem until you receive power from on high. The disciples were already saved when they saw the resurrected Lord. In the end of John, he even blew on them and said, receive ye the Holy Spirit. They were already sealed with the Holy Spirit. They were already saved, but they were still up in the upper room. Peter didn't go out and preach boldly. It says that, you know, like when he preached there on the day of Pentecost, when he preached and when they were beaten, when they preached in front of the Sanhedrin, it says, Peter, being filled with the Holy Spirit, began to speak boldly. What brought the boldness? What brought the boldness? Was it the resurrection of Christ only? No, because after they saw the resurrected Christ, they didn't go out the next day and start preaching, hey, I just saw Jesus, he's resurrected. No, they didn't preach to anybody until the Holy Spirit had come upon them on the day of Pentecost. Jesus said, you shall receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you to be a witness for me in Judea, Samaria, and the uttermost parts of the world. You have to receive power from on high. You can testify and witness all you want in your flesh. You sound like canned spam. You sound like a Jehovah's Witness. You sound like a Mormon. It's just blah, 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 blah. In my church, they had evangelism explosion, which came from D. James Kennedy, a Presbyterian church in Coral Gables, Florida, and it worked for him. So we did it at our church on Sunday school, and now we're going out and repeating some, you know, even these churches, they have a little card, you know, a little witnessing card, following some script. Sound like a brainwashed, you know, Kool-Aid drinking follower of Jim Jones. The Bible says those are led by the Spirit. These are the sons of God. Jesus said, don't think in advance what you're going to say, but when you're brought into those situations, I will give you what to say by my Spirit, the Holy Spirit. Will call you to remembrance of what you need to say. Not in your own flesh, not in your memorized quotations. That is not the power of God. That's why we don't have revival in the United States. That's why we don't have all the people saved. That's why all the people going to hell, because the church is not a light, a beacon on a hill. Jesus said a candle, you know, you can't hide a candle under a basket. You got to set that candle in the window so it can be seen. A city on a hill cannot be hidden. The problem with most of the churches, they're down in a valley, full of sin, full of the devil, full of wickedness, full of lying tares controlling the church. Now, when I went to the States, I only preached in a few churches. You know why? 99% of the churches are controlled by the devil and his people and all these boards and directors and all this stuff who are sent there and assigned by Satan himself to make sure that the gospel message is not preached in power of the Holy Ghost. Even Assemblies of God and all them now, they want you to have a PhD to be the preacher and all this other stuff. It's all a bunch of hogwash. As an example, Assemblies of God Church in Conroe or Montgomery, Texas, Cowboy Church. They don't allow speaking in tongues in the church because they're afraid the children will be afraid. That is a lie straight from the pit to block the power of God from moving into church. I don't care how cute they are in their cowboy hats and cowboy shirts and just to get people to come. They have a rodeo and a barbecue at the church and all this. What are they doing? Winning people to rodeos? Winning people to barbecue? This is a typical example of what's going in all the churches across America, even all the supposedly spirit-filled churches. They're winning people to themselves. They're building their own kingdom. God didn't call us to have a barbecue, even though there's nothing wrong with eating. But that is not how we win people to the Lord. People are won to the Lord through the preaching of the Word. How can, you know, faith comes by hearing of the Word of God. That's what I went to the States to do. Guess what? The individual Christians who I had a chance to minister to, most of them received what the Lord gave me to give to the American church. But those alleged churches are few and far between. The amount of real Christians in the States, probably no more than there is in the Philippines. Truth be known. Truth be known. It's a bunch of social clubs and cliques and all this foolishness. They're building their own kingdoms and not the kingdom of the living God. And that's why the what I'm preaching is dangerous. It's dangerous to the devil's people. Oh, they hate it. Oh, it burns them up. They can't stand it. No, they don't want to hear it. No, they don't want to hear it. Wake up. They don't want to be woken up. And then half the people on YouTube, all they want to know is that the rapture is tomorrow. I think you need to be more concerned whether you're going in the rapture as to when is the rapture. I think you should focus on your own walk with the Lord and stop worrying about the rapture, because you may just be left behind, because the spirit that's in you is not of let's do the Lord's will, but the spirit is upon you, hey, I'm ready to escape. Brothers and sisters, the Lord wants you to know He is worthy alone. That's the main word that the Lord gave me, the quickened word the Lord gave me, is He's given the oil of joy, of gladness for His people, to replace mourning in His people. Those true Christians, God has given you the oil of His joy. Those of you who have been baptized in the Holy Spirit, may you be refilled right now with the Holy Spirit in Jesus' name. May you be filled with the oil of joy, which is the Holy Spirit, in Jesus' name. Those of you who have not been baptized in the Holy Spirit, may you be baptized in the Holy Spirit, in the oil of joy, in the name of Jesus Christ, the Son of the living God. And the Lord wants you to know He alone is worthy. He alone is worthy to take back the title deed to this earth from Satan. I'm talking about the natural title deed. He hasn't done that yet. We are living in the time, in the age, the church age, the year of Jubilee, the acceptable year of the Lord, where the Holy Spirit and the kingdom of God is within us. It is within His believers. But there is a day coming when the Lord Himself will return to this earth at the end of the tribulation, and this whole earth, there will be no more sin. There will be no more demons on this earth and all that stuff. God put an end to all that. Jesus will rule this earth with a rod of iron. He's coming back as the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. That's part of the gospel. That's part of the gospel that you don't ever hear anybody preach. Did you know that in China, in the above ground church, they have the underground church, but the regular, they have some Catholics, Protestants and all that. Did you know there's only one doctrine they're not allowed to preach? I've heard this from several Chinese preachers. They cannot preach about the second coming. They can preach the gospel and all that, part of the gospel. They cannot preach the part that Jesus is coming back as King of Kings and Lord of Lords. The devil hates that part. He hates that more than anything, that Jesus is coming back to literally in the flesh, in the natural. Jesus will rule and reign on this earth. This earth will be restored like the Garden of Eden. And the devil and all his people is going to be out of here. All these wicked people is going to be gone. There will be no more sin and all that stuff. The Lord is coming back to put an end to that at the end of the tribulation. And Jesus wants you to know He is the only one that's worthy to do that. You are not worthy. You are not worthy to take dominion over this earth. All these kingdom dominion people, you can't do that. Jesus Christ is the only one, the Son of God, the Son of Man, the only begotten of the Father, the Son of the living God, the Son of the Most High God, Jesus Christ of Nazareth, the Rose of Sharon, the Lily of the Valley, the Bright and Morning Star, the Wonderful Counselor, Everlasting Father, the Lord and Savior, Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus the Christ, the first and the last, the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end. He Himself alone, the stone that the builder rejected. Him, Jesus Christ, is the only one who has the authority to take dominion back over this earth. He alone is worthy. The Lord wants you to know He's worthy. This is what the Lord wants you to do. You know, there's all these people on TV who claim to be prophets, and they're saying, oh, the Lord is telling me if you're going to send $100 today, because today is the day of atonement, you send $100, God's going to save you. There's all that. Here's a word from the Lord. This is a real word from the Lord. The Lord wants you to begin to worship Him and tell Him how worthy He is. Tell Him how worthy He is. Don't worry about what they're doing on TBN and all this lying, demonic spirits and all these Judaizers on YouTube. Begin to declare that you are not worthy, and you alone Lord Jesus, are worthy. No one is worthy to take dominion over this earth. No one is worthy but you, Lord Jesus Christ, Son of the living God, Son of the Most High God, El Elyon, Most High God in Hebrew, Lord God Almighty, El Shaddai. Only you are worthy of all praise, all honor, and all glory. For you have overcome the world, the flesh, and the devil. You put them under your feet, Lord Jesus. You put them under your feet by your blood, by your death on the cross. You made a show of the enemy openly. You triumphed over him openly and destroyed the kingdom of darkness by your death, burial, and resurrection. You alone, Jesus, came to this earth, lived a sinless life, born of a virgin, suffered under Pontius Pilate, falsely beaten, falsely innocent man, crucified, and buried, and resurrected on the third day. Only you, Lord Jesus, have conquered the grave. You have conquered the grave, Lord Jesus. No man has ever resurrected himself. Jesus said in John chapter 10, I'm the good shepherd, and no one takes my life. I have the power to lay it down, and I have the power to lift it up. Why? Because he is the Christ, the only worthy one, is the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. He laid down his own life. Why? For you and me, because you're a sinner. Your deeds are a filthy rag. Your righteousness is a filthy rag in the eyes of God. Apart from Christ, you are nothing. I am nothing. Apart from Christ, we are lost and without hope in this world. We are sinners. You are not saved by celebrating the Passover and all that. As I just read from the text of the Gospel of John the other day, 2 to 3 times at least the Apostle John said that was the time of the Feast of the Jews. A Feast of the Jews. He didn't say, oh, all the church went up there with Israel to the Feast of God. He said, no. The Apostle John said it was a time for one of the feasts of the Jews, of the Jews, of the Jews, of the Jews, a feast of the Jews, which is a type and a shadow and a copy and an image that points to the very thing, as Hebrew tells us. People are worshiping the image and not the very thing. Jesus is the very thing. All things are fulfilled in Christ. He's the only one who's worthy. Stop trying to justify yourself. Stop trying to walk in self-righteousness. Stop trying to walk in the deeds of the law. For the Bible says, by the deeds of the law shall no flesh be justified. Humble yourself under the mighty hand of God, and he will exalt you in due season. The Bible that says that, and it also says, God gives grace to the humble, but he resists the proud. The American church is full of pride and arrogance. How long will the Lord suffer with the American church? Surely judgment stands at the door of the American church. For you have rejected your Christ. You've rejected your Messiah. The Lord said to the Laodicean church, he's talking to you. He said, behold, I stand at the door and knock. He wasn't talking about your heart. He's talking about the church. People keep saying, oh, it's about salvation. No, he's talking to the church. The church won't let Christ in. Therefore, judgment knocks at the door, and surely you will let him in. For one comes in his own name, and surely you shall receive him. This is a warning. There are people watching this right now. And Jesus will fulfill his word in you when he said, I come in my Father's name, and you would not receive me. But there's one coming in his own name, the Antichrist. In him you shall receive. And there are people watching this video right now, and you will receive the Antichrist. You will believe the strong delusion. Strong delusion sent by who? By God. God is sending a strong delusion because you refuse to believe the truth. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. Therefore, God is sending a strong delusion upon this apostate church.